Australian Photography Show is brought to you by Camera House, with 80 stores and 500 camera professionals Australia-wide. Today, on the Australian Photography Show, we're going to Death Row with Rob Miller to learn why backgrounds are the key to making portraits really stand out. Then, I'm going to put three of the world's best-selling compact cameras through their paces. And we'll learn how you can get a wow factor with Photoshop. Today, we're going to talk all about portrait photography. And the first rule is, find the best background you can. And that's why I've brought Nicole to Death Row. Today, we're going to meet Rob Miller from Image Tree. And Rob's not only an expert at portrait photography, he teaches hundreds of people every year how to take photos of their friends and family as portraits. And Rob, you've picked a sensational backdrop here.
It's fabulous, isn't it, Steve? It lends itself to a myriad of different backgrounds, and the backgrounds to me are the most important part of a photograph.
So you start with the background and work your way forward.
Yep, we see the background as a set and we see the subject as a placement in the set. Oh. In fact, I've got a bit of a saying, the subject is the most important part of the photograph, but the background's more important.
Well, let's go and see what background you've got chosen for Nicole through this way.
Good.
Oh, I feel like Johnny Cash.
And again. That's fine, that's around about F8. We'll take this to about F16.
So Rob, while you're in the mode of setting up this, tell me about what you're doing here with the light meter. Why is that so important?
Okay, we're setting the light on the background first of all, Steve. That's what's important, to get this thing looking good. Then our model will be about here. So that's her background, that's lit. There's also a slight spill coming across which will cut a little bit of an edge around her. And this is the light that's going to light the top part of her. Now I may pull it down a little bit tighter than a softbox, so I may put an umbrella in there but collapse it. Okay, because I'm after her face, her head, her chest, and not much else.
Okay, so you're going to focus on a certain area and almost fine-tune the lights onto that area as she comes in.
That's right, yeah.
So why this? Is it the contrast?
It is to a degree, but one of the things that we see like an egg, we don't see in a box. Okay, so you'll notice that this is quite bright in here and this is quite dark.
Yeah.
So we get that sort of vignetting effect, which you'd use in your movies as well.
Of course.
And that vignetting darkens the edges or can even blur the edges and then pull you into the middle.
Focuses your attention
on her,
on the subject.
Yeah. And the background becomes a support.
Rob, when you were setting all that gear up, all that gear ended up being only two lights. I was expecting banks of lights and a rack on the top and lots of helpers, but you've only got two. So starting with this one, what do the two do?
Okay, this is our background light. It's gridded. We want it very tight on the background.
And the honeycomb actually helps you create a focus, like a focus beam of light?
It does, but it also blends outwards to darkness, which gives us our vignetting effect.
So an actual created vignette, rather than using Photoshop, you're going to start with the background and create your own vignette there.
Exactly.
And that's your modelling light that's on at the moment?
At the moment, yep.
Allowing us to set our framing and then boom, this will be a flash when we're
ready
to go.
That's right, yeah. We just need to know where it is at the moment, so when you're actually looking through the model to the background, you can actually see where the light is.
So this won't hit the model, this will just hit the background?
It'll hit the background.
Wow, okay, so let's go and look at this one.
Okay.
If that is the background flash, this must be the model's flash.
That's right.
And that's a softbox.
It is.
Now, do you always use a softbox for modelling?
Not always. I prefer to use as hard a light as possible, but because of the nature of this girl, I just want to soften the light a little bit. You'll notice it's only a small softbox.
Yeah, really
a big
small
one.
Yeah.
Because I just want to light her head, her chest, and maybe down to her thighs, and that's it.
So focus on the features of interest.
That's it.
Take this back now to someone that's got a camera, their parents are over from overseas, and they want to light them in the same way. How do you do it quickly?
Okay, shutter speed looks after the background, okay? And the background is a camera thing. In other words, the camera's got to be set up to take the picture.
Right.
For the background.
So light the background first.
Yes.
Find a light place for them to stand.
Or even an exposure. An exposure that suits the background.
Yep.
And then the pop-up flash will fill the person to the background.
That's your built-in flash.
Yep.
And that light there is the light that's in the surrounding areas.
That's right.
Wow. All right, so we're ready for the model now. Let's wheel her in. Well, actually, we're going to go find her. The ghost might have got her.
Maybe.
There's plenty of ghosts around here, I'm told.
After the break, we'll start to work with our model and Rob will teach you how to manage your subject to get the best results. Then, later, I'll be testing three of the world's biggest selling compact cameras to find out which is the best for you.
Rob, we're almost ready and we better hurry because I can actually hear people over there and I'm not lying, I know them. They're hunting for ghosts. So before they all come this way, why don't we get going? First of all, you're gonna shoot the background, yeah? Make sure you like it. Great, it's bright enough.
I'm happy with that.
And now we're ready for Nicole. I'm sure everyone is, they're sick of looking at us. Hello. First of all, a couple of metres between the background and the model. Is that what you're aiming for?
Yep, because there's no shadows cast by this light of her on the background.
Very good.
In fact, if you look at the shadow, it's actually falling over here, which is outside the line that I'm shooting in. And what we do with the model, we work to her strengths. So, beautiful face, lovely hair. Okay, I want her side on to me, okay? Because that narrows her, but no woman likes their shoulders narrowed. So now we just bring the shoulder around this way like this. And the hands are just hanging, so we don't like that. So we'll just get her to hold the edges of the jacket, okay? Now we've just got to make sure there's no hair blowing across her face. Okay. I'll just get her to turn through center, so she turns her head that way a little bit. Now she brings her eyes back to me. Just bring your face back a little bit this way. That's good, excellent. Okay. Now, normally I get them to think about something. So if I want a serious look, I just frame her up and I just say to her, think of the last pet that you had that died.
Oh, really?
And I get that sort of look in the eyes, okay?
So as you see Snowball go through the tire tread, that's the shot you want.
That's the shot I want. Okay?
Oh, great.
And then this might work or it might not work. I'll ask her to think of the last really nice present that her boyfriend bought her. Okay.
So you're trying to distract her really away from the fact that she's looking at a camera.
Yeah, because it's quite confronting to have this thing looking at you. So now we'll just try tilting the head a little bit. No, bring your head up a little bit straighter, chin down a little bit.
Beautiful. You're creating angles there. That's what you're doing, aren't you?
Okay. Now just look at me with those eyes. Good. And again on three. One, two, three. One, two, three. The reason why we count to three is because we don't want the light causing her blinking.
So give people warning that the photo's coming.
That's right, that's right.
This is nice, mate, what's this? What's a Canon?
It's a Canon, yeah.
Oh, it's an EOS 20D.
Yeah.
So let's say I wanted to get a bit crazy with crazy angles. Do you recommend that?
Okay, but first of all, before you do that, check where your background light is.
Okay, my background light is in front of her.
Okay, so if you go over to your left, it'll now be right behind her.
So you want it right behind her?
Possibly, it's up to you, it's your shot.
I want her to look down on me. So is this autofocus at the moment?
Yep, just on the eyes, centre on the eyes.
Three,
and the reframe.
Two, one, dead cat.
Okay, now she's a little bit lost there. Give us something to think about.
Well, I gave a dead cat. What more can I do? All right. Think of you've just jumped off the Empire State Building and ops, you've forgotten your parachute. Three, two, one. Wow, I like that. That works.
Excellent.
That really works.
Now, would you like to do something a little bit interesting? Just stay like that.
What's more interesting than off the building with no parachute?
Bring your feet together. Okay. Now, on three, she'll do a little jump in the air.
Oh, jump in the air. Okay,
so
I like it.
Just make sure there's enough space for her to jump into. Ready? So bend your knees slightly.
At the top.
And then on three.
Three, two, one.
Not too high, just a little one. No, sweet.
Actually, that's all right. This
just
is
a, just
really
a little
good.
One. Just a little one.
3, 2, 1. Right. The camera didn't go off.
Okay.
3, 2, 1. Oh, I see.
It's all in the timing.
It is the timing. Open
3, 2, 1. Lovely.
Okay.
Like it.
The hair goes up slightly.
It does.
Yeah. Just gives it a little bit of buoyancy.
I prefer that to dead cat.
Do you?
So, Rob, if this was the 1950s and we were bad boys, we'd be having our dinner here right now, I'm afraid. I don't fancy that much. But it is an awesome place for photography, and using two lights, such a simple way to go. If you're going to sum up portrait photography, though, in just one sentence to make everyone a better portrait photographer, what would it be?
The old favourite, Steve, keep it simple, stupid.
Don't call me stupid. Of course, it's easy for him to say, put your arm there, hold this, turn your head that way. But if someone just thrusts a camera in your face, what's a good tip for people to make sure they don't come off looking like Shrek?
Don't say cheese and over-smile.
Don't say cheese.
You get a really big grin and you look quite funny. Try not to blink, so try and keep your eyes open. And
should you ask him for a countdown?
I like to, yeah.
Yeah,
just go like, give me a second and so I can get refresh myself and things like that. So you're not just going, oh, gosh, like, OK.
Yeah. Of course, there's always going to be the friend that takes great pleasure in making sure you look as bad as possible.
Yeah, you always get one. You'll always have one or two bad pictures, so.
Yeah, you can't even think about that. One or two. That's pretty much every picture of me ever taken. But that's why I'm not a model.
Next, I'm going to take three of the world's biggest selling compact digital cameras and put them through a series of tests to figure out just which one is right for you.
It's product test time again. We're at a camera house store with my friend Colin. Cole, you haven't got any $10,000 Ferrari cameras for me today, but we have got the sort of thing the average person will probably want to buy. Tell me what I've got here.
Exactly right, Steve. We've got, like in the case of a Lumix camera here, great high-quality compact camera with a lens from Leica.
Leica, a real Leica lens.
So for most of us, this is as close as we're going to get to a Leica lens in a compact camera you can use. Great sensor, great low-light performance, and intelligent automatic. Really great travel camera.
And here?
Well, moving on to Mr. Nikon, this takes your zoom out a little bit further. So our zoom goes from a 3.5 times out to a 7 times zoom, which gives us more at that long end when we're zooming.
200 tally to a 28mm wide angle.
That's about all you'd ever need for a travel.
Yeah.
Icing on the cake for me is when I take the camera up to my viewfinder, we can then use a viewfinder. So I can use this on a sunny day outdoors as well as indoors. Great all-round camera.
Absolutely. And you've got to try Canon. This is the G12.
Well, that takes it a little bit further. You've got a lens in between these two. Great build quality on the Canon G12. And you've got a finder that you can move the finder around.
Yeah, flip out
and there
screen.
You go, look.
I like
so
that.
So what
one.
A great feature.
Well, I'm going to go for a bit of a drive around with all three, try them in different situations. Let's see who comes out on top. Now, of course, compact digital cameras, they're all about ease of use and speed. You've got them at a party, you've got them on holidays, you want to take a photo, the kid's doing something cute. First thing you want to test is, how fast does it switch on? And the answer is, really fast with this Canon. This is the G12, 10 megapixels, which is pretty much the norm. One thing you notice straight away is, the zoom is right on top of the shutter button, really in a terrific place. The thing I don't like quite as much is that after you've taken the photo, there is quite a processor lag before you take the next one. So if you miss the initial shot, you do have to wait maybe 3 or 4 seconds before you can take the next one. But for scenery and for ease of use, this really is nice. Of the three, I'd say this Canon is the easiest to use. And it has a 5x zoom, but one of the features I love is the automatic macro feature. Pretty much run these cameras all on auto. And you can get to within a centimetre of your subject without changing any settings. And easily with one hand, I can set the autofocus, take my shot, centimetre away. That is a terrific feature. Auto ISO as well, so it'll adjust to the light conditions that you're in. And then straight away, I swing around, do a wide landscape shot without changing my settings. I really like that. The fact that you can angle this screen anywhere you want it means for taking low-down photos, you can really, without getting too dirty,
get a perfect low angle or any sort of angle that you need. I really like that. And it seems to take good photos through the water as well without a polarizer, but of course it's not waterproof. However, having said that, Canon always have a great range of underwater accessories, and you can put this in a housing or any number of other accessories you can buy for it. Take it in the water and get beautiful underwater photos too. But let's compare it to the Nikon and see how it goes. This is a chunkier, heftier sort of camera. And like most Nikons, it's just loaded with features, even more so than the Canon. First test again, does it turn on quick? Heck yeah, it's ready in an instant. Now, first thing I notice as I look through that viewfinder is the zoom is in an excellent place right near the exposure button, like the Canon, but I don't like the viewfinder anywhere near as much. However, the live view at the back is very, very good. Quick autofocus, but unlike the Canon, it won't flip out. So that is definitely a disadvantage, but where the Nikon comes into its own is that with a small camera like this, without spending the money or having the complexity of an SLR, you do have a lot of SLR features, an amazing variety. In fact, it even has bracket exposure for HDR photography, quite automated bracket exposure. That's great for a compact camera. So let's take a shot on extreme wide, and then let's zoom right in and test this zoom. Oh yeah, I tell you, it's an excellent zoom, but I have to admit once again, I don't like that viewfinder that I'm looking through. It does process images quicker than the Canon, and I like that a lot. This does have the feel of a quality SLR about it, really. Has a good manual mode, but I like this. When you turn it to scene mode, and you want to shoot a panorama, you take your first shot, and it gives you, through the left third of the viewfinder, the image to line up with the next shot. Click. It's like a ghost image where you can easily line up what you've shot and keep shooting panoramas until it's done. That's a very big panorama to the point where I've even got the cameraman in shot now. Terrific stuff.
Stick around, because next we'll test the Lumix LX5, and then you'll learn how to make your photos stand out using the autumn effect.
While the Canon is extremely automated, and it has a great macro, the Nikon, you have to select the macro, but when you do, you can get just as close, and there's tons of bees on this grevillea. If they don't sting me, this is just a really simple way of taking macro shots. That one was a bit too close for comfort. I like this a lot. For a compact camera, it's hard to see how you're going to do better. Something this Nikon does very well is HD video. In fact, it'll do 29 minutes of 720p, which isn't really full high definition, but good enough video. And it'll quite happily go from a wide distance shot and focus on these bees quickly and seamlessly. Through the viewfinder, I can't actually see it focus at all or hunt the focus. Very impressive. This Nikon really is for the sort of person that likes gadgets, likes to play with things, read the manual, and come to terms with all of the kooky features. If you're like that, I reckon this is a camera you'll like a lot too. Well, it's a beautiful day now, and the light's right overhead. Very vibrant, and this is perhaps my favorite camera of all. The Leica-inspired Lumix LX5 from Panasonic. It really feels like a Leica M4. My favorite part is the viewfinder. Even with dark sunglasses on, I can see everything clearly. I don't have to take them off. And with multi-point exposure and autofocus, the shots that you get out of it, they're almost impossible to mess up. The screen's so big. Once again, the Canon does have it over because you can't pull the screen out unless you've got a screwdriver, and I think that voids the warranty. But something that I found this camera has over everything else I've tested as well is, I'll take a wide shot, I'll zoom up and take a tally shot. The processing time is very, very fast. The zooming is very, very fast. As something you can just pick up and take photos of the kids or a party, the great outdoors, this is perhaps The best one of all for me. Perhaps the place that this camera just excels is the video mode. Right now, I'm shooting a sand whiting against some sand in video mode. I can see it clearly with sunglasses on through the viewfinder, and it's looking through that water like it's not even there. But more than that, this camera has some amazing video functionality. By going into the menu, which is as easy as one button click, you go to film mode, and you can change from standard to dynamic, nature shots, smooth video, vibrant, real colorful video, black and white, and even dynamic black and white. So this is the sort of camera that you'd buy if you're really into the artistic side of photography, but didn't want the hassle of an SLR and all of the complexities that come along with it. So while the kids are screaming in the background, I'm gonna shoot a water video in black and white. Oh no, that's art.
Colin, I'm genuinely surprised that in the field, I had a ball using these because there wasn't too much to think about. But if you like thinking, if you're a bit of a techno nerd, that's your camera, the Nikon. I can see why you like it. There's a lot of control, isn't there?
Exactly right. You've got the combination of the big zoom lens.
Yep.
In this case, a 28 to 200.
Yeah, that was a real feature I liked.
Going to bring that in. And you've also got control, very quickly control between exposure compensation, function compensation on here.
Yep.
But the real nice thing about the camera is you've got the viewfinder.
Yeah.
So on a sunny day, I can take the camera to my eye.
That's
and
right.
And I know I'm going to nail my shot.
Exactly. But for me, maybe the Panasonic LX5... It feels like a M4E, and it's not a real Leica lens, but it's made under license from Leica, and it just feels M4E. I really want it, and it's a nice little fashion statement too. If you want something chic, it's the camera. So maybe my choice there, but having said that, over here you've got a Canon that is such a great all-rounder because it's very simple to use, isn't it?
It is. And the screen is
well, the fact that it can do that and the others can't almost sells it for me, but then, voila. That is the underwater housing. Have a look, it's sensational. Oh, I'd be happy with any of these cameras, but in the ocean, the Canon.
Makes it.
For a fashion statement, I love the LX5, but the Nikon is for the nerds. Anyone that you get as a present, you're gonna be happy with.
Exactly.
Post-production time again, and today I'm going to show you just a quick little trick that can take a photo that you kind of like and add a bit of punch to it to really impress your friends. They're calling it the Orton effect, named after Michael Orton, who uses this sort of style in his photographs. He does it in a lot more complex way than this, but have a look and I'll show you a really crazy way to have some fun with your photo. Starting off with just any old photograph, but hopefully with a nice focal point in the middle. First thing I'm going to do is create an adjustment layer down here, and I'm going to use the exposure adjustment to really overexpose the background quite a lot and to wind the gamma down too. Now that's a pretty hideous looking shot now, but it's all going to make sense in a minute. The next thing I'm going to do is right click and I'm going to say duplicate layer, and I'll move that layer to the top. And I'll change my blend mode to multiply. So far, it's not really doing much other than create a sort of vignette. But now when I say filter, blur, Gaussian blur, watch what I can do. It gives it a surreal kind of look, everywhere from almost nothing to extremely strange. And by changing this as your last point of adjustment, you can create a very dramatic looking shot. And your friends will all say, "How did you do it?"
On the next episode, we're going to meet a Getty photographer who'll talk about a career in sports and action photography while showing you how to turn your kids into stars when you shoot them on the sporting field. See you then.
I've seen empires rise and fall out of the sky. I've watched history unfold like the iron butterfly. I've danced through life. life with diamonds on my feet. A long road that runs right to my